when we talk about certain issues, we put weight on empirical evidence more than we value anecdotes and anecdotal evidence, and that really has to change. When someone is telling you about a phenomenon, your answer shouldn't be, we're not sure. And with climate gentrification, it's been a couple years since people started describing this phenomenon. It shouldn't have taken this long to go, well, let's look into this.
We have heard from community members living in Little Haiti specifically, and also Liberty City, that they get knocks on their doors and offers to sell their home. And those offers will often be cash offers that also come with a period of time where they can have free rent in South Dade, so in Homestead, for example. So that's something that we've been hearing about a lot, the pressure to sell your home and then also to move to this lower elevation area that's more susceptible to sea level rise.
So the difference between gentrification and climate gentrification is that gentrification really only relates to housing. It is definitely harmful, but it's harmful in a way that it can tear apart the fabric of established and really important and culturally relevant neighborhoods. It does not always mean that people will be put in the path of harm. That's where climate gentrification comes in. When you're talking about climate gentrification, you're really talking about risk and level of risk and vulnerability. We know that Little Haiti sits largely 8 to 10 feet above sea level, and Homestead sits 2 to 3 feet above sea level. So yes, here's an opportunity to buy more properties and to short term increase your value and your net value, your assets. However, when we get another storm, when sea levels start rising enough, if anything were to ever happen to Turkey Point, Homestead residents are going to be considerably more vulnerable than Little Haiti residents.
This is years in the making of people understanding this property, the area where it's located as far as how close you are in terms of proximity to the beach, downtown, the airport. So it's a hot zone, hot location, and the climate aspect, we now know that this is high elevation. We know that when Hurricane Irma came, you know, the beach got flooded. Downtown got flooded. But TIET didn't get flooded.
We talk about climate gentrification in Miami when it comes to sea level rise. But climate gentrification could also be proximity to wildfires or an area that's prone to mudslides. So things that just put you in harm's way or moving you closer to being in harm's way.
I really think climate gentrification is just adding on a layer on top of like traditional gentrification or displacement. You know, here in Miami, climate change is probably the greatest issue that we're facing in terms of threats to existence. Caroline Lewis from Clio Institute always says climate change is a threat multiplier. It kind of adds on additional stresses onto what are already critical issues for our community.
In the history of Miami, Miami Beach has been the primary demand driver, right? Everybody wants to be close to the water. So traditionally, those areas along the waterfront, including areas along the Biscayne Bay and downtown Miami, have received most of the development activity over the last 30 or 40 years. Today, that shifted a bit, and now we're seeing more northwest movement. They're seeing a lot more development pattern and development activity heading towards the northwest.
So we're seeing significant redevelopment pressure across Miami's various neighborhoods. In Little Haiti, for example, between 2000 and 2013, we've seen a 70% increase in the number of households earning over $100,000 per year, and a 20% decrease in the number of rental units that are affordable to lower-income households. We've mapped some of that redevelopment pressure. We're actually able to visualize it through our mapping software. So we could show you how many properties in Little Haiti, Little Havana, and Alapata that are currently owned by a company. And some of the results are really striking. In Little Haiti, for example, 22% of all single-family homes and duplexes in broader Little Haiti are owned by some type of company. To give you a sense of scale, it's only 6% countywide. So Little Haiti has more than three times the rate of single-family homes and duplexes owned by a company than the rest of Miami-Dade County.
The neighborhoods that are currently the case studies, if you will, for climate gentrification as a phenomenon are Little Haiti, Little Havana, Liberty City, Alapata, Overtown to an extent. these neighborhoods are historically of color. Black and brown folks inhabit these neighborhoods. And further than that, they are socioeconomically challenged. They've been historically disinvested in by the city until just recently. And what is unfortunate is that these neighborhoods are not only historically of color, they really are cultural epicenters that you cannot find, not only in other parts of the city or the county, but also in other parts of the nation.
We took the initiative to clean up our community.
What makes up a community is the people, the land that they stand on, and between that, what they are able to create with each other. And if you look at that angle and you see that there's more people in terms of demographic moving into a community, and you're starting to see because of the land itself that they're taking away, they're also changing the culture and the lives of these people. When you take the land, you take the nightclub that was here. You know, you take that, you take the daycare that was here. You know what I'm saying? You're taking something that's dear to them.
So the causes of gentrification are extremely complex, and it's hard at this point to make a determination of how much of an impact sea level rise is having on Miami's redevelopment pressure.
I don't think people are leaving Miami Beach to move to Alapata. To me, that would be the definition of climate gentrification, where people are migrating from a low-lying area, and by virtue of what they're expected to pay or what they were paying, they move into another area and affect the pricing. What's actually happening is Miami's growth is just driving people to those areas because they tend to be areas that are accessible to the employment centers, accessible to public transportation, and accessible to the other city infrastructure that's developed downtown at a lesser land cost or at a lesser development cost.
The city is undergoing a lot of development interest, right, in many parts of the city. There are areas of high elevation that are undergoing high development interest, but also lower lying areas along the Miami River that are just that next wave from downtown. We're tied for third as the fastest growing city in the country.
I don't think that developers are going out with a topographical map and saying, I'd rather buy this site because it's 5 feet higher. I think that they look at the site specifics of development, and if they're in a low-lying area, they have to contemplate what design am I going to have to employ to be able to get the correct insurance rates and to be able to build this in a sustainable way. So I do think the developers are considering elevation in their decisions. I don't think they're seeking sites intentionally just because it's on the coastal ridge. I think the developers are actually just looking for larger tracts of land to do projects, and we're running out of truly vacant sites in the other areas of the city that you would normally purchase. So you either have to buy an existing building, be prepared to demolish it and redevelop it and so forth, or you can buy for much cheaper land in some of these outlying areas.
For me, it doesn't necessarily matter what the intention of a specific developer is. I think it's a clear fact that people are being gentrified out of their neighborhoods, and that if they're moving to an area that's more susceptible to sea level rise, that they're going to be more climate vulnerable, and that's what climate gentrification is. And I really believe that's what's happening in Miami-Dade County.
The climate gentrification resolution passed unanimously and was largely heralded as an innovative effort by the city. There was press coverage because there has been no other municipality that has committed to studying and understanding the issue. And so to me, that applause that we got figuratively comes with a sense of responsibility to then actually follow through.
We are acutely aware of the fact that in Miami, gentrification is an issue. And that said, it serves, in our opinion, no great purpose to focus exclusively on climate gentrification as such. It serves us best, us in the planning department and us in the city of Miami, to include climate gentrification as one component of all the gentrification forces that affect the city of Miami and tackle them as a whole. To go any further into simply trying to isolate the instances that are a result of climate gentrification would frankly be to go forward in a fool's errand. We miss the point if we don't tie it into all the other factors.
Given that it has been almost 1 year and we are no closer to having the intentional solutions that we wanted as a result of this resolution, I cannot say that the support is there to really make inroads on this issue in a timely fashion. I don't think that there is a lack of will to address the issue, but I think that there is a lack of understanding. And there is a lack of understanding just how pressing this is and just how pressing it could be if left unaddressed.
I think we're in the early stages of really assessing all the factors that attend and that influence gentrification generally, and I'm frankly not in favor of moving forward in a rushed fashion because there is much data out there that we need to obtain and we wouldn't want to miss to really inform good, sound policy long-term. At least from the planning department standpoint, the long-term outlook is always the important thing.
And we don't really have years to waste. There are residents that are being displaced right now. There are neighborhoods that are being hyper-gentrified right now. And so we do need timely solutions, but the idea behind the resolution was to make sure that we have at least done the background research to make sure that those resolutions, those proposed solutions will be effective and to make sure that they are surgery and not a Band-Aid on a stab wound.
Whether or not you believe in climate gentrification, gentrification is happening now, displacement is happening now. The people that have been in Miami for decades, that really have built this city and made the city what it is, can no longer afford to live here. They're looking at places like Broward and Orlando, and then when you add climate concerns on top of that, it doesn't help alleviate this at all. We need to really start protecting our residents.
It's very easy to ignore this as being an issue, a poor people's issue, or a black and brown issue. But it's everybody's issue. This city is a beautiful place only because of the people that inhabit it. And so it's really on all of us to keep our city beautiful and to keep our city vibrant by keeping our city diverse and making sure that we are protecting those among us who have just historically been pushed around, who have historically been disenfranchised, oppressed, largely so that this city could become what it is today.
We need more investments from the government, and we also need more understanding from private sector that's coming here to understand what's going on with our community. It's not just Highland of Elevation, there's culture here, and there's beautiful people here. There's a strong force in terms of having to be resilient. I know there's a lot of IEC investors who are not selling. They've taken that decision to not just only sell, but to fight back to who they are, right? Not necessarily like, but fight back with saying, this is our community, you know, let's beautify it. So my vision and our vision for this community is a resilient one by the day after we all still here. It's not one of a somber and people are gonna get washed out. And the fact that I'm here, that itself is such a strong statement to this community.